Goldstein. I'm very happy to have on the Goldstein on Gelt Show, Professor John Allen Paulos from Temple University in Philadelphia. He's written a number of books, and one of them in particular caught my eye, called A Mathematician Plays the Stock Market. So, John, are you a fantastic stock market investor?
I'm not sure there is such an entity, but I generally invest in broad-based index funds, and I don't really think you can beat the market unless you can front run and have all kinds of contacts and so on.
But there are a lot of smart guys like you who are mathematicians. You'd think that this really just a numbers game. Why can't they, really look deep into the numbers and find some answers?
Well, I mean, people claim to be able to do so. There's technical analysis with all kinds of terms such as head and shoulders and floors and ceilings and so on. And fundamental analysts who look at profit and loss and all kinds of other qualities that characterize a company. But and can you make money using those techniques? The answer, of course, is yes. But the real question is, can you make more money using those techniques than you can in investing in broad-based index funds? And there it's not so clear. Well, perhaps if you devote your life to it, yes, and have all kinds of help with computers and contacts and whatever.
I certainly think a lot of people have devoted their life to it, and they've tried many. In fact, when I was younger, when I was still in high school, my brothers and I, both of them were engineers, and this was in the day when our fast computer was an Apple II Plus, we decided we were going to figure out the system. And so we went to the library, which for those of you who are younger is like a big building where you get a lot of data. And and we looked on microfiche, again, for those of you who don't know, it's like looking at old newspapers, just to get the closing stock quotes of the Dow Jones for a couple of years. And that was our database. And then we ran formulas. And ultimately, we found that we were right a little more than half the time, which we thought was all we needed to make money, until, of course, we discovered we were suffering from what's known as, I think, data leak, which is our formula was actually taking into account the fact that we knew what was going to happen tomorrow. But smarter guys than us, I'd like to think, would be able to find certain patterns that would repeat themselves, which is really what the technical guys say. Why do you think that's not true?
Well, if it were true, people would, not just technical analysts, but everybody would glom onto it and arbitrage away whatever small advantages there might be. And in fact, that's true for any kind of insight or whatever. If you invest on the second Tuesday in January, or you wait for oil to do this and then you go big, it might work, but then next time it's going to work far less well, and people will arbitrage, as I say, arbitrage away the difference. I mean, the market is, in gross terms, efficient. I mean, new information is reflected more or less quickly in the stock. But it's only grossly efficient. I mean, cognitive foibles come in, behavioral finance, confirmation bias, all kinds of foibles to which we're all subject. But on the whole, it's efficient. There's an interesting paradox regarding the efficient market hypothesis, and that is that the market is efficient to the extent that people believe it's not. Because if people believe it's not efficient, they'll scramble around, they'll look for every possible advantage like you and your brothers did, and by doing so, bring about efficiency. Whereas if people do think it's efficient, they'll let their assets languish, and the market will gradually grow inefficient. So again, efficient to the extent that most people believe it's inefficient. But it's broadly efficient with lots of deviations from efficiency. And then you also have to worry about fat tails and black swans. So even if the expected value is reasonable, you'll win, let's say, most of the time, and a very rare horrible result will wipe that out. So the expected value might be negative, even if on most years you do very, very well.
We're talking with Professor of Mathematics from Temple University, John Allen Paulos, who is a best-selling author on a number of his books. And the one we're talking about today is called A Mathematician Plays the Stock Market. Now, John, one of the things you said really kind of caught my attention, which was you said, well, some people say if you buy in the second Tuesday in January, or you know you should buy in the winter and sell in the summer. And there are a lot of these theories which would seem to be reasonable when you backtest them. And of course, I'm the first guy to tell you that past performance is no guarantee of future returns. But it does seem that there's something to these theories. And there are many, many more we could go through. Am I missing something? Is it just random that these theories seem to work on average over the years?
Well, if you look at stock funds, I mean, the ones that are featured on the front page of business magazines and newspapers as being performing in a stellar manner in 2015 or 2014, they're just as likely to perform below average or even horribly the following year. Despite the exorbitant salaries that managers of stock funds generally receive, it's like the Sports Illustrated cover jinx. I mean, you write about people that do well in this or that sport, and the next month or next year, they're likely to do less well as a regression to the mean. But in a way, it's kind of a scandal that the highly paid fund managers don't really, in the long run, do better than chance. I mean, people focus on it when they do well, but they neglect to look at them when they're not so well. I mean, just as there's a cover jinx in the Sports Illustrated, the analog of what I'm talking about would be the back cover, the player that did horribly.
Is this a similar concept to what people refer to as the black swan?
A black swan is a very unusual, generally negative result that people don't take account of. And but it's not just that. I mean, just regular white swans, I mean, vary a little bit, and the stock managers don't generally do better. I mean, they make money because no matter whether the market goes up or down, they're going to make money. There are lots of scams that are based on that. I don't think we have time to go through them. But if you make money whether it goes up or down, in a way, you don't really care. And there's confirmation bias. I mean, you talk about technical analysis. Why don't people give it more credence? Well, one reason is that random returns are hard to recognize as random. Random doesn't generally look random. One thing I do in my classes is I have half the class go home and flip a coin 100 times and record the sequence of heads and tails, and the other half just make up a 100 symbol sequence of heads and tails the way they think a coin would behave. And the latter group, I can always tell when they hand in their papers the next day, because they don't leave in enough runs of heads, enough runs of tails. The frequency of runs is far below what it should be. And they don't, the total number of heads versus the total number of tails goes back and forth. First heads is ahead first part of the time, then tails. But that's not what happens. The so-called arc sine law shows that there's an equal chance of whether heads or tails will dominate in this 100 symbol sequence, but whoever it does, or whichever it does, it will probably dominate the whole time. In other words, more heads will at any given time have resulted than tails, or more tails at any given time will have resulted than heads. And there are other behaviors of random sequences that, again, don't look random. So people, don't have a good yardstick, and as a result, they think things work when they really don't. In addition to cognitive foibles like confirmation bias and the anchoring effect and status quo bias and so on.
Right. Those are very important behavioral finance issues, which we have actually spoken many times on the Goldstein on Gelt show. In fact, we had the guy who won the Nobel Prize in it, Daniel Kahneman, as a guest a couple of times.
Oh, yeah. He's a good guy.
Yeah. Just to explain it to our Goldstein on Gelt listeners. You know, John, one of the things that I think a lot of people would say after listening to, quite frankly, your rather pessimistic view of money managers is, well, if you can't really get a benefit, should you be investing in the stock market at all? What do you think?
I think, yes, by and large. I mean, historically, for lots of reasons, population, demographics, technology, improvement, the stock market goes up. I'm not saying don't invest in the stock market, but as I say, broad-based index funds generally go up. They have broad-based and low fee, and you're not taking that much of a risk. But what that entails, however, is giving up this romantic illusion that you're a kind of gunslinger who'll go and really, you know, clean up. You won't. You're kind of resigning yourself to doing as well as the market does. And overall, present appearances perhaps not so confirming. Overall, the market goes up and you'll benefit. But as I say, you'll have to give up the illusion of being smarter than everybody else.
Got it, which I think is a good lesson for many, many people, because no one has prophecy and really no one can know for sure what's going to happen. So I think diversification and using indices is a very, very good tool, which is probably why it's so popular these days. John, we are just about out of time, but in the last few seconds, tell us about your new book and how people can follow you and follow the work that you're doing.
Sure. A Numerate Life is my latest book. It's partly personal, partly mathematics. I use incidents from my life as jumping off points to discuss mathematical notions that help us analyze all our lives, not just mine. And I think it's pretty good, by the way. it's available from Amazon. And you can follow me on Twitter at John Allen Paulos, JohnAllenPaulos. And my webpage is also johnallenpaulos.com.
All right, and we will put links to all of that at the show notes of today's show at goldsteinongelt.com. John, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it.
You've been listening to the Goldstein on Gelt show with money maven Doug Goldstein. Doug's weekly radio show is heard around the world, but if you miss it, you can download the podcast at www.goldsteinongelt.com. The Goldstein on Gelt show gives you up-to-date financial ideas so you can get on the path to financial freedom. If you'd like your questions answered on the air or off, send Doug an email to doug@profile-financial.com. It's your money for your future, so join Doug every week to build your wealth on the Goldstein on Gelt show.